Hey friends, if you're in the business of creating live games, you need to think about how you engage with your players and how you support their needs. PlayFab gives you a complete back-end platform with the game services, the real-time analytics, and LiveOps that you need to create world-class games. And James is here to give us a look at what's possible today on Azure Friday. Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman, and it's another episode of Azure Friday. I'm here with James Gwertzman, and we're going to talk about PlayFab. This is such a cool idea, I can't even stand it.
I love it.
So you describe this as Unity for the cloud?
Unity for the back end.
Unity for the back end. So I can go into Unity right now, and I'm a C# developer, and I can go and even go to a Unity marketplace, and I can buy a Jeep and buy a skin of a person, and he can go and start fighting, and I can get that working locally in a weekend. But then I got to go and do the back end, the leaderboard, and where these two characters are. And suddenly I have to discover and write a bunch of code that I really wasn't into. I want to do the fun stuff.
Yeah, exactly. Games have changed. I mean, games are all now operated as services. It's no longer enough to build it and ship it in a box. Now you launch it, and then the real work begins. You're operating this game day in, day out for hopefully years.
Yeah.
And that requires pretty massive back-end infrastructure. And so we started PlayFab specifically to build all these services. And it's a little bit of CRM, who are your players, a little bit analytics and data, what's happening in your game, a little bit content marketing, content management, adding updates and assets, a little bit commerce, selling items in-game, virtual currency, tracking inventories, promotions, and all kind of bundled up in one package.
Right, that's not what I signed up for. I want to do the fun stuff.
Yeah, you want us to do the plumbing, the totally non-sexy stuff. You get to focus on the fun.
Yeah, and when you describe it like that, there's so much going on in the back end. You would even argue that the game is 20% of it, and the running of the game and the management of the game's cloud back end is 80% of it.
Yeah, if you look at the typical game that's live for a couple years, by far more work happens post-launch than ever used to happen pre-launch, and that's a real shift.
Okay, so what can I do with PlayFab, and how do I get started?
All right, let's take a look. So I'm going to go ahead and take a game that's live on our platform today called Adventure Capitalist.
By this is a real thing?
Real game, live today. It's a mobile app. They have an iOS and Android and Xbox and, and Facebook, a bunch of platforms.
Cool.
So we're looking at a live feed right now, and what you're actually looking at.
Really? This
things.
Is real? Like,
this
is a real humans logging
Real humans playing
in.
Right now. And so what's happening right now is we're getting a feed of what's called PlayStream. PlayStream is a live event feed of raw data coming out of the game into the back end.
Okay.
And this data is flowing through the process. And we're gathering basic stats and metrics and analytics about how the game is performing.
Wow.
But to actually give a bigger demo, let me jump into a demo game we have called Unicorn Battle.
Okay.
Unicorn Battle will let me show off sort of more of the real-time nature of what we can actually do. Because a big part of this is our ability to change what's happening in the game while you're actually playing it.
Oh, wow. Okay, so I can see that you just logged in and you're on your main screen here. What's going on? We've got, this is your demo, so you've had, what is MAU in the last 30 days?
Right, so that's the number of players who've played this game in the last 40 days.
Played the demo.
That's exactly right. So, okay. So for example, I'm in the game right now. If I go ahead and play a battle, we'll see right now, is fight a boss. It's a very simple demo game.
Okay.
So I'm gonna fight a boss, here we go.
All right.
And I just beat the boss, hit continue. And if you go back now to our PlayStream feed, you can see a whole bunch of events just came in. And this is a real-time dump of what just happened in the game I was playing. So where this starts to get interesting is I can actually jump in now and take a look at my actual player profile. Let's look at who this Jimmy G character is.
Okay.
And I've got, for example, a bunch of statistics. And so my statistics are tracking data about my player. So for example, right now I've got XP. 4,140 XP points.
Oh, wow. So this is literally the name, value, pair, bag of stuff about Jimmy G.
Exactly right. And so I can go into my player profiles, and I can look at how I've decided to segment my players out. So I've got a segment here called high XP players.
Okay.
So these are all players where I'm segmenting based on how much XP I have.
Mm.
And what's interesting here is that a lot of times you have marketing systems that can reference marketing data, but can't get at the actual real-time data from the game itself.
Right.
And here we're allowing me to take an actual game property like XP and use that to group and compartmentalize my players.
Right.
So for example, I've got this that I can segment on things like when I first logged in, how long I've been playing for, how much money I've spent. In this case, I'm using XP. And these are all the stats that I've got in my game right now.
And could I then use that, you said you call it a marketing segment, I could go and give them access to a forum, I could treat them with special emails or special notifications?
That's exactly right. It's exactly what you can do with this. And so, and because it's all real time, if I go in now and look at my segments, I can see this character Jimmy G, I'm in the high XP player segment.
Mm.
But if I go in now and change that, just for the sake of this demo, back to 2900,
which I think as a player, I'd be a little bit sad to know that you can change my
I just nuked your XP. I'm now no longer in that high XP.
Oh, it happened immediately. It didn't happen at a batch at night. It happened immediately.
And where this gets interesting is how we can now change what's happening in the game based on that. So, for example, take the economy of my game.
Okay.
I've got this notion of what we call catalogs, which are things you can sell. So this is the part of the product where you manage everything you sell in your game. Mm-hmm. It's things like virtual items like potions or swords. It's also hard currency items like coin packs, like 1,000 gold coins you can buy for $9.99 on Apple, let's say.
Right.
So here I've got all my different items in the that I can sell. I've got this notion of a store, which is a collection of these different bundles. Mm-hmm. So I've got this gem store, which is all the different packages I can buy of gem packs. Medium gem pack, small, large, extra large. And I can do things like rearranging these around if I want to move them around to help, you know, manage my store. Mm-hmm. But in this case, I have the ability to override what store a player sees based on their segment. So I've got this notion of if I'm a high XP player with more than 3,000 XP, I'm going to show the player a different gem store. I'm going to show them the WH version of the gem store, which is going to have not the small, medium, and extra large bundles, but I'm going to actually sell, for example, let's go look at that one. The gem store WH is going to sell medium, extra large, mega, and epic gem.
Right.
The idea being my more advanced players should have a more advanced set of things that they want to purchase. And so what I can do now is I'm going to go back to the game. Let's go ahead and watch this in action. So okay. Here I am in my game. Let's go ahead and view that store. So here's my gem store. There we go. Here's my gem store. Let's go back to that.
A little bit to your right.
Okay, there we go.
Okay.
So here my gem store. Sure enough, medium, small, large, extra large gem bundles. That's the basic
set
of gem bundles.
So that happened. You didn't close the game and start the game up again. Your game coder made that call when they opened up the store then makes the decision at that point.
Right, so the game said, get me the store. And they're asking for the gem store. And what came down is my gem store. But now if I'm going to go ahead and play that same battle, jump in here and play that little battle and fight the boss. Okay. If I look now at my set of player profiles.
All right.
So here's all my stats. You can see this my stat XP changed. My total XP gained went from 2,900 to 3,520.
You just became a high XP player.
Just became a high XP player.
Okay.
And so now if I go back into the game and go to that exact same gem store I was just looking at.
Okay.
I'm now looking at a whole different set of bundles, medium, extra large, mega, and epic gems. So the store just changed, and it changed because I just changed segmentation. Now, you may decide as a game designer that's not something you want to do in your game, but the fact that the game can now change its behavior in real time based on what you're doing, all by doing, you know, UI click and shifts on the back end, that's huge.
Well, and the fact that I as a game designer can conceive of that and do the fun part, which is the expression of the store and the graphics of the store and the game experience that the customer sees, and not worry about the administrivia of the back end. You gave me a back end already. I have a gaming back end as a service.
Right. And another example of what you may want to do now is how do I maintain that relationship with my players?
Mm.
Because a big part of these games as services is it's no longer just selling it in a store and I don't know who played my games anymore.
Right.
Now I can actually have this sort of two-way conversation.
Mm-hmm.
And so if I wanted to, let's say, promote a special event to my high XP players, I have a whole set of tools which you can use to go in and message these players.
Okay.
So let's take a look at our task system here. So I've got this notion of, for example, I've got it right here. I've got this sense of giving a gift to my high XP players.
Okay.
So it's going to be a task that's going to run. Going to run an action on every player in a segment. The segment is those high XP players.
Mm-hmm.
And I can do, for example, a push notification where I'm saying, hi, in this case, display name.
Right.
You just got a gift. And I'm actually going to grant an item from the catalog to the player's inventory.
Okay.
So I'm both sending a message, which is a marketing task, and giving a gift into their inventory, which is more of a direct game backend task.
And that'll be a push notification. Then I can click on it, and I assume then the game developer on the front end could click and jump into
anywhere they want. And they can deep link straight to the game. Exactly right.
So cool.
So simple little task. I'm going to go ahead and run this task right now.
All right.
And you can watch the task kind of queuing up here in the task manager.
That's going to everyone, not just you.
All my high XP players,
right?
Because it's a demo game. There's only a handful of us.
Mm-hmm.
And so let's take a queue up here. And then we should, so it's starting up.
Yeah.
And then in a few seconds, we're going to get a bing on my phone, and a message will come in saying, hey, you just got this gift.
And it can be, and it'll happen in the game, but if you weren't running the game, it would happen outside the game.
That's
and
right,
you
push notification would arrive, exactly right. So
I can't even imagine how much work would be involved for me to go and do that when, again, I'm focused on writing a great game and having a great experience. The flexibility is
exactly
amazing.
It's not something you really want to. So sure enough, you can see right here, I just got this push notification saying, Unicorn Battle, hi Jimmy G, you just got a gift in Unicorn Battle. And so that message coming in is straight from the back end side.
That's so cool.
And if I want to look at my player's inventory, I can go and see that just came in the... I can first look at the player's event history, mm-hmm. which is all of the events that we're tracking for this particular player. So here I'm looking at this history mm-hmm. of every single event over time generated by the game. So you can see, looking here just at the last 24 hours, these are my events. And sure enough, the very most recent event here is player inventory item added, medium health potion. Mm-hmm. So that health potion went into my player's inventory, and now it's available for my use.
Would you build the support system, like the back-end support people for your game as your company becomes bigger and bigger? Would you build it on top of this? I don't think I'd want any old random support person at this level of game ops.
That's a great question. So we have a whole roles and permission system for exactly that.
Oh,
so
fantastic.
Yes, you would. So we would go into our settings, mm-hmm. and we would define a set of roles for this title. Let me show you how that works.
I see, because I don't want one of my support people letting their buddy get, you know, extra high XP.
Exactly right. So you can go into roles, and you can define what you're going to create your different roles to be. So mm-hmm. for example, I've got an admin and a dashboard.
Right.
I've got this custom role here called customer service. So what do I have settings for customer service people? My customer service reps have no control of the economy,
can't
limited control
things.
Over players,
yeah.
Limited control over add-ons, limited content control, and so on. So you can create your profiles, log them in, and they can use this for service recovery, view player profiles, but not make the changes you don't want them to make.
Wow. Okay. So I'm sold. How do we get involved? How do I get this?
Great. So you go to PlayFab.com, and PlayFab is actually cool. We chose to make it free for a pretty wide swath of games. It's mm-hmm. free up to 1,000 players, no matter what.
Yeah.
Beyond that, certain set of features are free for forever,
sure.
up to 10 million players. The rest of the features, you have to have a professional account. And you can go check out our pricing page to see how that works. It starts at, I think, $8 per 1,000 players, mm-hmm. per 1,000 MAU, and goes down from there. And so there's a bunch of different tiers available. But it's the Essentials tier. We really believe that every game deserves a back end. And we have the notion of the Essentials tier, where every game can get these basic features no matter how many players they have.
So cool. Thank you so much for sharing with
cool.
me.
Thank you.
All right, we're learning all about how to get a game backend as a service with PlayFab today on Azure Friday.